to you by Penguin.
Keep Him Close, written by Emily Koch and read by Deryn Edwards. And as you grew, light gathered in you. Carol Ann Duffy, The Light Gatherer. Never, 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 never. William Shakespeare. King Lear, Act 5, Scene 3. It should have been louder. He would think later about all the other people, only meters away, who must have heard it. A taxi driver on Queen Charlotte Street, with his windows lowered in the August heat, picking up the post-pub crowds. A pot washer from the Italian in Welshback, tossing rubbish bags out of the kitchen glow and into the dark. A double bassist with the blues band playing at the Old Duke, packing the boot of his battered Skoda. He would wonder if it was louder for them at ground level, or for him, 10 meters above the road, too scared to lean over the edge and look as the screams and howls began and the sirens floated closer. That thud, when flesh connected with tarmac. He knew the truth as soon as he heard it. Still, for a few seconds, he waited for a laugh or a shout. He waited to hear his own name pitched up from the road. But you don't survive that kind of fall. He didn't need to look. The sound was enough. That cracking thump, heavy and hard, but too short and nowhere near loud enough to measure up to the life it had marked the end of. He had to get away from here. Alice, 17th of August. Was there a more irritating sound than the laughter of other people's children? In the impossible heat of the loft, Alice had considered for a moment opening the skylight, but that would make the din louder. They were probably on their scooters. Thank God those hadn't been around when her boys were small, flying down the alleyway that linked Alice's road to the allotments butting up against the bottom of her neighbour's gardens. She hadn't yet lifted the lids on more than 3 boxes, but already sweat pricked at the skin across her back. It pooled in the creases behind her knees as she crouched. It made her eyebrows itch. She carefully untied her hair and plaited it again, sweeping the stray strands from her face, splitting its bulk into 3 precise sections, and lifting the weight of it off the back of her neck. This room was an oven, but she would not open that window and intensify all those whoops and shrieks and giggles, or, God forbid, the parents' laughter. That was always somehow worse, though she couldn't decide whether it was a mother's glee or a father's that repelled her more. She looked up at the neat rows of boxes stacked on the shelves, scanning the typed labels. Plugs and electrical items. Bulbs and fuses. Vinyl, A to H. Vinyl, I to Z. One box on the top shelf contained the old turntable she and Etienne once put to use every evening. Next to it were 2 more, whose labels had faded, but she could just about make out what they said. Board games and Christmas decorations. Neither had been touched in years. She pulled one marked B and L, March 2006. To September 2010, onto the floor and lifted its lid before leafing through exercise books and school reports. This wasn't what she was looking for. What are you doing? Lou's deep voice behind her made her jump, and she slammed the lid down, creating a cloud of dust. Where did you spring from? She coughed, turning to face her younger son. He sat on the edge of the loft hatch, legs dangling over the ladder. How long had he been watching her? She caught a glimpse of something in his eyes, something she could not quite identify. It was quickly replaced with a grin and the mocking arch of his eyebrows. Got something to hide? She stood, reaching a hand out to the slanting beam above her head. The answer's no, Lou. The grin disappeared. She had correctly deduced why he had sought her out. It wasn't to see what she was doing. As in, no, you haven't got anything to hide? She pressed her fingers harder against the warm wood of the beam. Lou pushed himself up from the hatch and shifted his attention to the light cord, plucking at it repeatedly to switch the bare bulb on and off, keeping her eyes on him. Alice listened to more children racing through the alleyway. Surely it was past their bedtime. Those parents would be the same ones complaining after the school holidays that their little darlings wouldn't settle back into a reasonable nighttime routine. Every September, they'd come in and moan to each other in the kids' section of the library. She'd make an excuse to take herself off to the health and well-being section upstairs, or sort through the disparate collection of leaflets, covering everything from fostering information to rambling groups, choral societies to a local chess club, by the entrance. What did they expect? Children needed discipline, consistency. She'd given that to both her boys, so what had gone wrong? How could one of them become Benny and the other turn into this scruffy, disrespectful dropout in front of her? Lou had not long turned 18, and she didn't like the man he was becoming. He kept toying with the light cord, on, off, on, off. She ran a hand across her face, shielding her eyes. Stop that! He didn't. Looking for the birthday cards we used to make you. So he had remembered after all. She didn't care about these things. She wasn't bothered about presents and flowers. But the lack of respect from her boys got to her. She had seen 45 years come and go, and she'd dedicated almost half of that to them. And today, even Benny had failed to say anything. No, she lied, pressing so hard against the beam now that her wrist ached. I didn't keep much. Hoarding is for people who can't let go of the past. She meant it. She hadn't kept many things from the boy's childhood, and whenever the time felt right, she streamlined her collection even more. Today, she was angry, both with them and with herself for caring. Today, she would get rid of the few old cards she had held onto. Lou let go of the light cord, flicking it at the wall, and gestured at a pile of boxes in the far corner. Over there. You saved some of the ones Benny made. She didn't move. It drove her mad that he knew her so well. You've done an inventory up here, have you? She laughed. Watch it. You'll make me proud if you're not careful. He snorted. Kill me before I become as anal as you. She had kept some cards made by Benny at school. He was right. None from Lou, though. But that was only because his had upset her so much. Even at the age of 4 or 5, he'd known how to hit a nerve, signing them from Louie and Daddy. Or including his father in a crayon family portrait of the four of them, where her face would invariably be drawn into a frown. If he knew that she hadn't kept many of his childhood drawings, then presumably he also knew she did have a box with Benny's hospital bracelet, his baby blanket, a curl of his hair, one of his tiny white vests. And that there was no box with similar mementos of Lou, born less than 2 years later into a home full of noisy discord and hurt silences. Alice looked at him. She couldn't imagine him caring. If pushed, she could explain it. The lack of a baby box for him had seemed appropriate, she would say. He'd never been very babyish, not with those knowing eyes he had. To this day, he remained a strange mix, a wise old soul, and a petulant child woven into one. As if on cue, the childish side of him emerged. He began jumping from one side of the open hatch to the other, landing only a few inches away from the edge. Lou, don't! It's not safe! She knew she was talking to herself, and turned her back on him, resuming her examination of the boxes on the shelves. The boy's extensive collection of books, CDs and DVDs, filled most of them. She always thought of the loft as hers. But it was their space too, she supposed, if a room was claimed by the amount of a person's belongings contained within it. There was little of hers in here. Lou's feet thudded behind her, followed by the creak of the floorboards under his shifting weight as he lined up his next jump across the hatch. Safe's boring, maman, he said. She closed her eyes and tilted her head to one side, biting her lip. Maman. He did it on purpose. Who wants to be safe? He continued. Thud, creak, thud. It's all about the thrill. Thud, creak, thud. That's what makes it exciting. Alice fished out a tissue from her pocket and dabbed the sweat from her forehead. She knew Lou wanted her to watch him, that he wanted her to beg him to stop. Instead, she lifted the boxes she'd been through back into their places, matching each label with the corresponding stickers on the shelves. When Etienne had been here, the loft had been full of instruments, and a mess. He needed to keep his old guitars, just in case, he'd said, along with dozens of boxes full of records. She should have sold them when he moved out, rather than looking after them until he was ready to take them away. She certainly could have used the cash. It might have fed the three of them for a couple of weeks. There had been unusual drums and other percussion picked up on his travels, which he claimed might be of use someday. It would all be part of Benny's musical education, he used to say. Not any more. Now there was less of him in here than there was of her, and that took some doing. Casting her eyes around, there were only two things she could see of hers. One was a box of old piano music her father had delivered one day, with the explanation that he didn't have space for it, and she should really consider playing again. She'd ignored him, but kept it up here. It was comforting to occasionally flick through her collection of Mozart, adorned with neat pencil notes in her teacher's hand, marking up the fingering for particularly tricky runs, circling tempo changes she was prone to miss, identifying moments when the music should be breathless or she needed to toss the note away. It was reassuring to thumb at the corners at the bottom of each page, folded ready for a quick turn mid-performance. She was struck suddenly by a mix of memories. One of playing Mozart's Fantasia in D minor when she was pregnant with Lou, her first feeling of his kicks as she floated her wrists through the adagio's beautiful tugging sighs section. The other of her teacher's voice as she played the same piece as a girl. Breathless. Popcorn in her belly. Lift your wrist, now drop it. Lou's tiny unborn feet dancing. She tore her eyes away from the box to her suitcase. Plain, black, sturdy, and little used. It looked tempting as she stared at it now, with Lou continuing to launch and land behind her. But she would never be that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.